In the last video, we have seen the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test as a test for differences between two distributions, where one of the variables has to be at least ordinal scaled. And this time we will see an alternative test for that, an alternative procedure with the same purpose, but with a different approach, and which also has a bit different prerequisites for the variables. So in case of the Mann-Whitney U test, which is also known as the Wilcoxon-Rang-Sum test, we need again at least one ordinal scaled or interval or better scaled variable that we test, and in the case of a two-sample test, at least one nominal scaled grouping variable, the variable with which we can distinguish the two populations to each other. So essentially we only need one ordinal scaled variable or better. And the idea behind that test is the values of this variable are sorted according to their ranks, and then for every group the ranks are compared. And I also would like to show you that how this is done in the background, and later on we will see shortly how this is done in R. Some words why we have two different tests, and I refer here to an earlier version of my slides. As we have seen, the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test tests for the shape of the distribution. So if at a certain point the shape of the distribution exceeds a distance from the shape of the other distribution, then the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test is significant, and it doesn't matter where this actually takes place. So the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test considers the whole distribution, but on the other hand, it is rather conservative, so it doesn't reject the null hypothesis quite easily, which makes it not such a strong test. In difference, the Mann-Whitney U test looks more to the location of the distributions, of both distributions, and if there is a stronger difference between, let's say, the center of the distribution, so the location of the central tendency, then the Mann-Whitney U test has a significant result. And for that, both distributions must follow approximately the same shape. Otherwise, the test might give you a wrong result. And we can construct one example here with this race between the hare and the toad. So the hare is here H, the toad is T. And we can see who wins the what was the several hares and several toads, and the number or the order in which they have reached the goal of this race. It's admittedly it's an artificial example, and we can see that the hares were usually faster and the toads were usually slower, but you can see that here there are some toads that probably due to rocket drive or whatever were faster than the hares. And when we look at the distributions here at the box plot, it's absolutely clear that the hares have smaller placements here. They were faster in general and the toads were slower in general. But due to this shape of the distribution, you can see that the mean values kind of are close to each other. Also, we can see here that both distributions, if we plot the density, are quite different from each other. And in that case, the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test can see a strong difference here between the two distributions because it considers the shape of the distributions, while the Wilcoxon or the Mann-Whitney U test or the Wilcoxon-Rang-Sum test can't see a significant result here, and that's why we get a p-value here of 0.14, why the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test gives us a p-value of 0.02 or 0.03 to round that correctly. So in case that we have a strong negative and a strong positive skewed distribution, you compare them, then the Wilcoxon test might not be the best test to use. On the other hand, in general, if this prerequisite is fulfilled, that the distributions are more or less equal in their shape, it is stronger because it's not so conservative. It rejects the null hypothesis easier. So in that case, it gives us better correct result when there is actually a pattern taking place, when the distributions are kind of even or similar. So that's why one has to look to the distributions and then decide which test might better suit the data at hand. So either the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, the conservative version, or the Mann-Whitney-U test, which is in a way a non-parametric version of the t-test, but it's also in a way not perfectly non-parametric, since we have to consider the shape of the distribution first before we can apply this test. Okay, how this is now done? I refer here to an example of Niels Müller-Schesel, and we have here the chamber sizes of Iron Age burial chambers divided by sex, and you can see here the chamber size and the sex of the individuals. W means female, M means male burials. And we could question now, do the sizes differ in relation to the sex of the buried individuals? So do men or women generally get bigger graves than the other sex? And from that we can probably make some conclusions about the social organization of these societies. So at first we have to, because it's a rank sum test, we have to define ranks. And the rank is which is the biggest grave. This gets the rank 1. And then the next biggest grave here gets the rank 2. And so forth until we get to the smallest grave here, which gets the rank of 10. Because we have 10 cases here in this example. So if we have then decided on the ranks, or have put the ranks to the graves, we can order them according to the ranks. And if we do that, we get this table here. Here are the original identifiers. This is the ordered data set according to the rank. We could also have directly ordered by chamber size. So this is equivalent. Of course, rank 1, if we order by ranks, also should include the biggest grave here. So we would have inverse sorted the burials according to the chamber size. When we have sorted them, we divide this whole table into 2 according to the sex, like this. So we have still here our sizes and the sex and the rank. And now we look for the individual burials, how many of the other type are in ranks below this burial. So in this case of the first grave, we have a male grave. So we consider the female graves, and females below are 5, because 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 burials are in rank lower than this male grave. And the same is true for the next case. So here still 5 female burials are below this male grave, and also for the third case. In the fourth case, we have a female burial. Now we count how many male graves are below this female grave. And these are 2, because there are only these 2 male graves still lying below that. Next, we have a male grave. And now we count again the female graves. So we have 4 here. Next male grave, the same 4. And for the next female grave, we have actually 0 male graves below, because we have already used all of our male graves, so to say. So we note down here zeros. And if we sum that up, we have in total male below, we have 2, because it's only coming from this individual case here. And female grave below, we have 23, because if we sum that up here, we get to the number of 23. So these are the numbers, and also the total number of cases that we have to consider, which then are used to calculate the test statistics. So we have in total 5 male burials, we have 5 female burials, we have a rank sum for the male burials of 2, and we have the rank sum of the female, of the other way around actually. The male burials should be 23 and the female burials should be 2. But it doesn't matter in which order we have the numbers here. And if we compare the product of the number of graves, it should equal the sum of the rank sums. This should be in all cases the same, so in this case 25. If we have identified our rank sums, we in this case used smaller of the two values, so we have either 2 or 23, and we use 2 to look up in a table, or at least this you must do if you don't have a statistic program available. So for example, in the quantifying archaeology from Shannon, there's the table B, which gives us the threshold values for the men with new test. And if we look this up here, we want to have a significance of 0.05, the standard significance. We have our number of cases N1 and N2, and if we see the appropriate cell in the table for 0.05 and the row for 5 and the column also for 5, the threshold number is actually 2. So since our value here is equal or higher than the value in the table, equal or lower actually than the value in the table, we can assume that the chamber sizes do differ significantly from each other. This is the procedure if we don't have a statistics program, but we have one, we have R, so we can do the same procedure in R. So I will do that directly in live. At first, when I have started R, and probably I am here in the Smarter project, I have to make sure that I'm in the right folder. So we work on the data in session 5, and I select that as working directory. And I will use the data from Kuhlberg, which is a data set about Bronze Age axes. And I read that into the variable Kuhlberg, which should contain the result of read CSV of Kuhlberg 1968. And I can see here there is an error going on because this is actually a CSV2 format. And now I can look into the dataset and you can see we have Länge, which means length, and the type of the individual axis. So to test that, we need to know how does the test in R, the command, expects our data. And to do so, we can look up into the help file, and in R the test is called Wilcox test, so we have to know that in the first place. And when we know that, we can look up into the help file of the Wilcox test, and there we can see that the command expects an X and an Y value in case of a two-sample test, so that must be a numerical vector of the data values, and the Y the same. So we have to split up our data set according to the types, and there are several ways to do that. I go for the rather long way this time, and I decide to make two variables. One is Bikun, other is Segun, according to our types. And I select from our original Kuhlberg data for the Bikun part those lengths where the Kuhlberg type equals to Bikun. So this gives us a logical vector with true or false, and only where true is given back, the result of this selection here is selected, and false are omitted. And with that, I have all the lengths of the bkun axis, and I can do the same for the segun type. I then have all the lengths for the segun axis. And if we have prepared our data now in that way, most of the time, most of the stuff in R is related to preparing the data correctly for applying a method, we can directly and very simple make Wilcox test bkun segun. If we do that, we can see that we have here the test statistic, which is the one that we have calculated before by the rank sum. Here it's called W, and this version of the test considers the higher number, not the smaller number. But it doesn't matter, because the higher number depends on the smaller number, so it doesn't matter in which direction the whole thing goes. And we have one length here, 12.9, that also occurs in the segun type. That results in that we have a rank here 0.5, because we have a draw here. And that's also why we have a warning down here, because if we have a draw, if we have two values of the same rank in both data sets, we can't calculate exact p-values, but the p-value, the approximated p-value is enough for us, and this gives 0.02 or 0.0227, which is still below 0.05, and so we have a significant difference between the two types of axes here according to their length. Okay, it has the same function in general like the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, but it's better in identifying significant difference, given that the basic necessity is fulfilled, that the distribution of the data are not shaped totally different. Next time, we will talk about another non-parametric test, that's the Xi-square test, and that's a test which is very robust and has very low expectations on the data. So you can compare distributions according to the nominal data, which makes it very helpful in many archaeological cases, and that's why we also will talk about this test later on.